So, as Natasha said, we're moving on, edging onwards. When we did that book that Natasha referred to, The Film Factory, we started doing that in the early 80s because we thought, Richard Taylor and I realized that there was a tremendous gap in coverage of what was then exclusively Soviet cinema, as it were, and we'd done a small booklet about the FEX group who bridged the 20s into the 30s, and we thought we should do something a bit bigger, so we did a volume of original texts, source texts, on the period on the 20s and on the 30s. And we really couldn't go beyond 39, we felt, because the state of research when we were planning that book in the mid-80s, we realized that there was so much we didn't know about the 40s and the 50s and the 60s. We did briefly talk about doing a subsequent book, but it soon became clear that that would be a very, very difficult proposition, because the study of Soviet cinema was so politicized, and one of our polemics in that book was to argue that we really had to look at what happened, take off the blinkers, not read it all in a kind of top-down way, as if the films were simply symptomatic of political directives. And I learned a lot, particularly during the 80s and even into the 90s, by talking to filmmakers, by getting to know a number of filmmakers and beginning to see how it had been from their point of view. And that was very instructive. I began to realize that it wasn't such a directive system as we had always assumed. And I guess the period that I really focused on initially was the 60s, because the 60s was a very exciting period of Soviet cinema. And by one could meet still many of those people, most of those people who had been major figures in the 60s, and really get to know them as individuals. So this for me is like a return to a really important launch pad for looking at post-war Soviet era cinema. And I'm going to, I guess we should try and do this in about an hour and a half or so, I think. Is that what you're expecting? I'll try and be quick anyway. So the format I'm going to follow is a few slides, just to give you a sense of the ground plan and to elaborate some of the background and introduce some of the figures that I'll be talking about. And then I'll show you a few extracts. But I've got something here which I'm not quite sure where to show this. Should have really thought that through. I've got a short video here. I wonder... It should play through my piece of equipment, I think. I wonder if it will. Because we haven't got any other way of playing video, have we, into a DVD? Well... this might be the answer. We'll get to that in a little bit, because this is a TV program that I scripted and narrated back in 1990, which covers this period and would allow you to see interviews with a number of the figures that I'm talking about. Maybe we'll keep it to the end and you can have a look at it then, and also some extracts from films that are difficult to show otherwise. So, where do we begin? Well, we have to begin really, I think, in 1956. As many of you probably know, 1956 is the period, is the moment, precisely, when the Soviet kind of consensus is broken by Khrushchev's so-called secret speech to the 20th Party Congress, where the delegates to this Congress, the Congresses have been relatively infrequent. This was the first Congress to be held after Stalin's death. And Khrushchev had emerged as the leading figure in the kind of vacuum, obviously, left by Stalin's time. He was the first secretary. And the delegates who trooped from all parts of the Soviet Union into the Great Hall, were asked to stay behind. And Khrushchev spoke partly off the cuff. I mean, it was scripted, but it wasn't tightly scripted, for about 4 hours. And people were asked not to talk about this, really. Of course, they could hardly fail to talk about it, because what Khrushchev did over that 4 hours was to denounce Stalin, to say that Stalin had been a tyrant and a bully, that he had taken credit for many things which he had not in fact done. One interesting section of this speech dealt with cinema, because Khrushchev in 56 singled out cinema and said that Stalin had made cinema an instrument for personal glorification and for kind of creating a great deal of mythology and certainly presenting a very misleading image of the country and of how certain things had happened. So filmmakers, if you like, were singled out for, well, not filmmakers so much as the cinema, Soviet cinema, was singled out as a prime instrument of Stalin's cult of personality. So that put an interesting kind of burden of accusation on the cinema. And one of the things that happened shortly after this process, which became known as de-Stalinization, was that Soviet authorities made it their business to collect all the copies of films that had been made in which Stalin was represented by an actor. And there were many. And they rounded them up and either suppressed them or re-edited them. So that from the point at which it was almost impossible to watch a Soviet film made between about 1939 and, let's say, the late 40s, 1950 actually to be precise, it's almost impossible to find a Soviet film that did not have some specific reference to Stalin, and even one of three actors playing Stalin in it. We went to a situation where Stalin disappeared from the screen completely. And I know this, how thorough this was, because when I put together a retrospective of Soviet cinema in, 88, I tried to find some key films from before 56, and it was impossible to find them. All the copies had mysteriously disappeared completely. So it was a very thorough operation. And some articles have been published since showing how Stalin was neatly edited out. I mentioned one of these, I think, in my last talk here, the film called The Viborg Side, which is the third part of the Maxim trilogy by Kosinsky and Trauberg, originally had Lenin and Stalin, obviously played by actors, looking down benevolently at Maxim. Well, in the only version that you could get, and can still get, it's only Lenin who's looking down. Stalin has just been wiped out. Never underestimate the power of Soviet retouchers. David King has written a wonderful book, which you probably know, called The Vanishing Commissar, in which he has actually documented all of these, this extraordinary process of re-editing the photos of the Stalin period, from which all the neglected, the denounced figures of the Politburo just disappeared from photographs. So you can get a photograph which started off with having 10 people in it, and eventually only has 2. It was an extraordinary process. Cinema underwent that process in the years after 56. 56 also saw the impact, the ripples that spread from Khrushchev's speech, spreading across Eastern Europe, and that's an image from the Hungarian uprising of 1956, which was in part fueled by the belief that the Soviet control of Eastern Europe was slackening, and it might be possible for anti-communist or even just campaigners against tyranny to take to the streets in both Hungary and the Czech Republic, and Poland rather. But they were brutally repressed, of course, in Hungary, and that attempt to take down statues of Stalin didn't get Hungary anywhere. What, and that just is a little sort of image of how cinema had been up to this point. The image on the right is from one of the more notorious of the Stalin, late Stalin era films, The Fall of Berlin, made in 1950 by Mikhail Chiarelli, which is a huge colour epic which purports to show, well, gives a kind of overview of the whole of the Second World War. And it ends with an entirely fictitious arrival by Stalin, who descends like a sort of white god from a plane, based on the Potsdam Conference, and he descends and people suddenly rush, having liberated from concentration camps, to pay tribute to him as the man who has liberated them. And this is Mikhail Gilovani, the most favoured of the actors who played Stalin. He's considerably more impressive than the real Stalin, of course. It really is like the Second Coming. He descends from a plane and it is the Second Coming. And that's one of the last great epics of Stalinist cinema. That's from a film made very slightly after, called The 41st, which is a remake of a 1920s film. And it's a film set during the Civil War. The story is set during the Civil War. It's about a sniper who is about to, as it were, shoot her 41st target. It's a woman, female sniper. And she doesn't. And in fact, she and her target take off together and have a little kind of idyll by the beachside. The story in the 1920s version was really a bit different from the normal Civil War story. It wasn't so heavily ideological. And by the time we reach the early 1950s, it's even less ideological. It's an excuse to do a romance with some framing that legitimizes it in the context of the Civil War. It's possible even for a dedicated sniper to, as it were, have a private life. And it's an indication of how stifled Soviet cinema was around the time of Stalin's death. It was still in a kind of straitjacket. Production had slowed to an absurdly low rate. Not enough films were being made to actually feed the cinemas, and the state of ideological control of films was extreme, cramping the ambition of any Soviet filmmaker. Then things changed. They changed in just a few years. And I would say that, this is, by common consent, these are the two films that signaled a dramatic change in Soviet cinema. On the left, The Cranes Are Flying, as it's known in English. A film which appeared in 1957, won the Palme d'Or in Cannes in 1958. Still the only Soviet film that's ever won the Palme d'Or, actually, or the only Russian film that's won the Palme d'Or. Well, the only Soviet film, to be precise, to be accurate about that. And that sent a signal, very important signal, to the wider world that the ideological control of Soviet cinema was certainly loosening. It's made by Mikhail Kalatozov. Kalatozov had been a director in the late 20s, Georgian background. Kalatozovili was his original name before he Russianized it. He had been an administrator during the 30s and 40s and had returned to direction only in the 50s. He took a long kind of career break to be essentially an administrator. And when he returned to make three rather remarkable films in the late 50s and the early 60s, he was really in the forefront of this new kind of spirit in Soviet cinema. It's very conventional in its setup. It's a World War II story, a great patriotic war story, as a huge proportion of Soviet films had been. But it's a complex story. It's a story about what happened on the home front. And it's a story in which black and white, good and bad, are not so obvious. and in which an extraordinary visual style is put on the screen. The camera work, the images in The Cranes Are Flying are absolutely astonishing, still to this day, by the great cameraman Urozevsky, who shot the three late films of Kalatozov. And the film is still astounding. I mean, if you haven't seen it, go look at it, and you will be astonished at the lyricism of the camera movement, the extraordinary use of the moving camera, extraordinarily dramatic lighting, and the sense, very dramatic, the sense of what it was like to be behind the lines, back in the on the home front of the Soviet Union during heavy bombardment of the Second World War. And also it tells a kind of rather romantic story about a woman who, you know, has been left behind by someone who's gone off to fight, and about the complex relationships that this creates for her and for the people who circle around her when she's on the home front. The other film is Ballad of a Soldier. Ballad of a Soldier by Grigory Chukrai was also, along with Cranes Are Flying, was seen as the other kind of film that really signaled a new direction, a new freedom. And again, it's a Second World War story, a great patriotic war story. It's a story that has been used several times. There are at least two or three other films that use the same idea of a soldier who's given leave from the front and who's allowed to go back home to see his family, his old mother, and what happens to him during that short break. He does get back, he does see his mother, but he meets various people along the way. And this picaresque narrative is a way of, again, exploring personal life. And the message that comes from both of these films is that a film which takes personal life, the personal life of a soldier or of a factory worker, as its focus, was permissible under the Khrushchev regime. Now, by the time we reach the late 50s, these two films were made, what's underway is what has become known as the Khrushchev thaw. The thaw took its name from a story by Ilya Ehrenberg, but it became a metaphor. The idea of a thaw in the icy fixed ideology of Stalinist Soviet Union took hold, and a lot of writing, a lot of artists, visual artists, writers, and filmmakers felt that they were living in a new climate, when there were new freedoms, new opportunities to experiment both with subject matter and with form. But of course they weren't always right. And one of those who paid the price famously was Boris Pasternak. This is the period when Pasternak wrote Dr. Zhivago, having wanted to write a novel all his life. And he felt that the climate was suitable for writing a rather personal novel, which would span the period from before the revolution right through until the 1940s. And he believed that he would be able to publish it. He had a tremendous reputation as a poet, as a man of letters, and he, up to the point where he submitted it to the censor, he actually believed it would be published. And he was rather shocked to be told there was no way it could be published. What happened was he sent it abroad, as some writers did. It was picked up by an Italian publisher, Gian Giacomo Feltrinelli, communist, Italian communist publisher, who published it in Italian translation. Then the CIA got involved. The CIA produced a Russian edition, which they smuggled into Russia. And so this became a great scandal, of course. Two books appeared about it just last year, the whole Pasternak-Zhivago scandal. I've just written a book about David Lean's film of Dr. Zhivago, so I've been digging into this, and it's a fascinating story. But it is a story of that period, of the hopes and expectations that were raised in the late 50s, and the way they weren't carried through. Although, in 1962, it was possible to publish One Day in the Life of Ivan Denisovich, which was published, which is a story set in the Gulag by Solzhenitsyn. And it's kind of difficult looking back from this distance in time to see why Pasternak's novel, which is totally uncensorious, really, of anything Bolshevik or communist. It is a very personal story of a poet and two women in his life. And Ivan Denisovich, which is intensely critical of the Gulag system, was published by essentially the same literary establishment. It was published in Novy Mir. What had happened between 58 and 62? Well, it's a very confusing time. It's a time when the promise of the early thaw was being challenged, and by the mid-60s, of course, Khrushchev had been sidelined and pushed out, and so the thaw was over. The period we're looking at, the Soviet New Wave, as it were, is precisely what happened between about 1960 and 67. So it actually runs across the period when the thaw is still more or less in operation into the period when it's very definitely not in operation by the time you reach 67. I hope that, well, I'm sure many of you know that already, but that's just to give you a sort of chronology. So just to, I've only got a few slides to show you, just to give you a sort of sense of some of the characters and the films from this period, and I'm hoping this will give you some pointers about things you might want to look at if you're not already familiar with them. During my period of intense involvement with Soviet filmmakers, I got to know Yuli Reisman. Yuli Reisman was the oldest living Soviet filmmaker. He'd started his career way back in the 1920s. He was still directing films at a very late age. And it was a great thrill to meet him because he'd seen it all. And he'd become a senior figure in running Mosfilm. When we had him over here for a visit, I did a retrospective of his films, we had a Q&A with the audience, and somebody in the audience asked the inevitable question, you know, who gives you your orders about what kinds of films you're supposed to make? And he looked, who gives me orders? I give the orders. He was mortally offended at the thought that somebody was telling him what to do. And I think that, you know, that was an insight into the way that Soviet cinema actually worked. It had high degree of autonomy by the 1980s, certainly, and more autonomy than perhaps we realize before that. These are just two films by Yuli Reisman from much earlier in his career. The Communist, made in 57, so it's a very early Khrushchev era film, is a picture of the Civil War, very different from anything that had been shown before. It's a very ragged, dirty, heroic, yes, but it's got mud, dirt, and everything. It is not the Civil War as it had been shown, which is very sort of sanitized. And it was really a film about a return to what were thought of as communist values, real communist values. The central figure is somebody who is heroic, self-sacrificing, but not in a kind of idiotic way. He is just plain heroic and self-sacrificing. But this is a really interesting film, Can This Be Love, made in 62. That's a remarkable film. It's a Beut film, a story of everyday life, set in a housing complex about a boy and a girl who get together. The girl becomes pregnant. What are they going to do about it? So it's really focusing on moral issues in a very realistic, very sympathetic way. And that, I think, is a very good example of the new spirit that was affecting even filmmakers who could remember the dark days of Stalin and who had been, you know, exposed to all of that through much of their career. And Reisman run goes all the way through. You can use him as a kind of barometer of what's possible. The last films he made were about people coming to terms with what their life history had been, really looking back at the Soviet era and what it had meant for elderly people. Those are the, what I would describe as the key figures of this new wave. And I'm sure they're all names you know. I spent rather too much time looking for early photographs of these figures, because we tend to have, I mean, there are a million photographs of Tarkovsky on the web, but they're all of the later Tarkovsky, because he always looked rather young right up till the very end. It's very difficult to date them, but I'm pretty sure this is an early photograph of Tarkovsky, because it's a bit pixelated, but he's actually holding up some material for Andrei Rublev, I think, if you look at it closely. And he looks, that's certainly a younger version of him. I once spent an evening with Andrei Voznesensky, the poet, who had been at school with Tarkovsky, who was an old friend of his. And he said, he told some very funny stories, including the fact that Tarkovsky had always been a bit of a flashy dresser, and he was denounced by his headmaster for being a teddy boy when they were at school together. This was an insult in the old Soviet period. He was a bit of a dandy, was Tarkovsky, very conscious of his bella figura. These are very central figures in the idea of a new wave, and this is the earliest photo I can find of them. Elem Klimov and his wife, eventually Larisa Shipitko. An extraordinary pair, both separately and as a kind of power couple. But they weren't a power couple in the sense that they didn't have power and influence, but they made some of the most interesting films of the early 60s, quite separately. Klimov's first four films were temporarily banned. So he had that characteristic experience of you make the film and then it's put on the shelf. They were all eventually released. And it was Klimov who was summoned by Gorbachev in 1985, end of 85, beginning of 86, to take charge of the Filmmakers Union, to sort it out. And it was very significant that Gorbachev chose somebody who had a background of being repressed. He had known what it was like to be a suppressed filmmaker. And Klimov did an extraordinary job for 4 years. He led the Filmmakers Union into the vanguard of perestroika. And he came to London several times during that period and was really a remarkable ambassador for the newly reformed Soviet cinema. Larisa Shipitko sadly died in a car crash at the end of the 1970s. She was making a film, The Farewell, in Siberia, and she was killed instantly in a car crash. And Klimov took over the making of the film and actually made the film, The Farewell, as a kind of tribute to Larisa. And I remember it was during one of his visits to London that he brought with him under his arm a film that we didn't know existed of Shipitko's, because it was only possible under perestroika to really discover what had been going on during that time, which we in the West absolutely had not known about. The other figure is Sergo, there are lots of versions of his name, many spellings of it. That I think is a pretty early photo of him. Parajanov was Armenian and also Georgian. There's endless confusion about who owned him. He was born in one place of parents from the other. And he was always an outsider in Soviet cinema constellation. And he made a series of films in the early 60s which he rejected and which were never shown in the West. They were considered to be highly unsuitable by him. He had rejected them. He felt they were films made under duress. In fact, his first film was made in 54, and he used to call that backdrop garbage. But in 64, he made Shadows of Our Forgotten Ancestors. This is what it's known as in English, which is an extraordinary film, which is imbued with a kind of pantheism, a sort of folk mysticism. And that caused a lot of anxiety in Moscow circles. and was withheld from export for a long time. It was one of those first films that became a sort of cause that people battled for to get to see it and to get it freely circulated. Parajanov had nothing but trouble after that. He was harassed by the Soviet authorities. He was imprisoned on at least two occasions. All sorts of accusations were made about homosexuality, trafficking, antiques, all sorts of stuff was thrown at him. And he became a sort of martyr figure in Soviet cinema for much of his life. But he was also emblematic of a new diversity in Soviet cinema. He was not somebody who ever made films in Moscow or Leningrad. He was resolutely out there in Georgia or Armenia. But there are many more characters, and I just want to kind of very quickly give you a sense of some of the other figures, because that new wave that I've talked about is much, much bigger than just these central figures. And many of these are still pretty unknown, I think, sadly. I'm conscious, as I was preparing this slide, I thought to myself, well, this is giving you the impression that it's only about directors. And I wish there was another way of representing the Soviet cinema other than by using directors as if they were the sole creators of the films. They're not, of course. At the very least, there are the actors, the scriptwriters, hugely important, always in Russian cinema and in Soviet cinema, very, very important, with a kind of autonomy. And even the producers. I mean, most people in the West don't even think that Russian films had producers, but of course they did. They had figures who were responsible for seeing them through, and very important figures who often remain quite unknown to the outside world, who really made possible the work of some of these filmmakers. So don't get the impression that it's just about directors, even though they tended to take all the credit. So just to give you a kind of sense of them very quickly, it is very quick portraits. Kira Muratova, still alive, still working in Odessa, at a pretty advanced age. Kira Muratova is another of those figures, a bit like Parajanov, who had a very early start in the early 60s. And made a number of films in partnership with her then husband. They separated, and she began to make more autonomous films, or films that she wrote and indeed appeared in. Her kind of first completely personal film, known as Long Farewells, is a film which she stars in. As well as directing it and writing it. Oh, no, she didn't write it, but she stars in it. She then did had a long kind of break when her work was suppressed, and under Perestroika she came back and made some of her greatest films in the late 80s, and she's still making absolutely fascinating, totally unclassifiable, highly personal films. Gleb Panfilov, slightly later starter than the others at the end of the 1960s. Panfilov films, again, you can date them from being part of the tail end of that early new wave. No Crossing Under Fire, that's 1967. Then The Beginning in 1970. And then I Want to Speak, in 75. And then in 79, Tiema, the theme, he hits the buffers, the film is banned, and he has to take a break for a time. But eventually it's released, and it becomes one of those films that is finally seen under new regime. Marvin Khutseyev, again still alive and still working. He was in London just last year. Very interesting, rather neglected filmmaker. He made one of the absolutely central films of the 1960s, called I Am 20. It's got two titles. It's called I Am 20, or the Ilyich Gate. And it's a great sort of panorama film of youth culture in the 1960s. And if we can get to showing you the DVD, I'll show you a little thing that we wove around that when it became possible to see the film in 1990. A long unseen film in which people like Tarkovsky appears in it, Voznesensky is in it, other poets appear in it as themselves. But he was a very early starter. He started making films at the end of the 50s, 59. He made the two Fyodors, but two returning veterans coming back from the war, which really is one of those early new wave films. Andrei Konchalovsky, that's the earliest picture I could find of Konchalovsky. I'm sure you've all seen his familiar later figure, but that's what he looked like back in the 60s, or at the end of the 50s. Again, still very much with us. And the only Soviet-era filmmaker who ever worked in the West, actually, still to this day. He made a number of films in America, gone back to working in Russia. The half-brother of Nikita Mikhalkov, and a contributor to this new wave period with some of his early films. One of his films was a banned film, Azia's Happiness. But his first film, The First Teacher, was part of the new wave, and it's that classic story of a teacher being sent from metropolitan Russia out into the Far East, as it were. Somebody that I've been very interested in, and I put together a season of his work, which I toured around America and Britain, because I think the West has never really understood just how important Vasily Shukshin is. If you talk to Russians, most Russians know about Shukshin very well, but he's never traveled very well, unfortunately, I think. Shukshin was a peasant from Siberia, and he began to educate himself, and eventually he went to night school, he got to Moscow, and he went to film school, to VGIK. In exactly the same year that Tarkovsky went to VGIK, which is rather interesting. So if you see this, Tarkovsky and Shukshin, and they were like, I suppose, oil and water. They were actually in the same year in the directing class. And Shukshin used to act the peasant. He would clump around in his big boots and play up his boorishness. Whereas Tarkovsky, of course, was very much the son of intellectuals, and had gone to one of the best schools in Moscow, and was really part of the Soviet bourgeoisie, upper bourgeoisie. So they're very different kind of characters. But I think very important to understand both of them. Because Shukshin was an actor. He appeared in a huge range of films. He was a writer. He wrote short stories. Extremely popular writer of short stories. And a director of about half a dozen key films, three of which are portmanteau films of short stories in the same film. He made a film that, his last film, got into great difficulties, Kalina Krasnaya, known in English as the Red Snowball Tree, something stupid like that, and he plays the central character rather wonderfully. And an extraordinary film called Pechki Lavochki, which has got no translation in English. It's sort of known as Happy-Go-Lucky or something like that. Anybody offer a translation of Pechki Lavochki? Any Russian speaker? It's a colloquial phrase. Nobody ever seems to have found a good translation for it. Anyway, it's an epic journey. He plays a peasant, or a farmer from Siberia, who with his wife undertakes a journey down to Crimea. And along the way he meets lots of people on the train. And it really, again, cuts a kind of cross-section through Soviet society in the 1960s. Very, very interesting film. Georgi Danelia, maker of comedies, ironic, bittersweet comedies. some of the most important films, like Autumn Marathon, which are really interesting sort of post-Thaw films that take a very ironic view of the bourgeoisification of Soviet society that was taking place after Khrushchev. And Uta Yosseliani, another Georgian filmmaker who, I think Yosseliani is still alive. I haven't heard of him dying. He's lived in France for many years. And all his last four or five films have been made in France. Very interesting figure. I mean, Russians have always valued Georgian cinema and regarded it as the most significant of the Republic cinemas during the Soviet period. And Yosseliani was very highly thought of, though his films are considered to be a bit avant-garde, a bit un-Soviet, which indeed they were. But films like it's one I'm thinking of. It'll come back to me in a minute. His early comedies, which are very kind of wistful, non-narrative films, were really part of the glories of the Soviet era of cinema. He was always included in a list of promising figures. And if you asked Tarkovsky, as people often did, who did he regard as, you know, his soulmates amongst Soviet filmmakers, he always chose Parajanov and Yosseliani. Those were the only two filmmakers that Tarkovsky was willing to endorse. And, as I said, the ones we didn't know. What people had not really known, I would say, they knew about the obstacles that were placed in the way of filmmakers of the 60s generation. We knew that because it was often very difficult to see the films of Tarkovsky, and all of films like Andrei Rublev, especially, was held up for nearly 4 years. But eventually it did get seen. And so I suppose there was a feeling that although there might be obstacles placed in the way of these films being seen by the various levels of the Soviet bureaucracy, eventually they would get out. But not so. Because what we discovered really in 1985 and 86 was that a significant number of films had been completely banned. They'd been made and they'd simply been put on the shelf. Soviet euphemism, shelved. And nobody knew about them, literally. And the most extraordinary one is Alexander Skoldov and his film The Commissar. Commissar burst on the world in 1986, and no one had the faintest idea that it had been made. I'm absolutely sure of that. I spent quite a lot of time with Skoldov, and he was hailed around the world. This became one of the most sensational discoveries of the perestroika period. I was in Toronto at the festival when it was shown there in 87, 88, and to see about 1,000 people kind of rise up and greet him was really quite an extraordinary sight, for him too, because his career had begun and ended with The Commissar. He'd made one film, and that was completely banned, and he wasn't able to work in cinema again. And there were several others like him. That's the most dramatic example. It had a very well-known actress in it, Nana Mordekova, and another very famous actor, Roland Bykov, who was an important actor right through the Soviet period, and even director. But the film had just disappeared. It had been wiped out. Why, you may ask? Well, it's a story set in the Civil War, which is approved, of course. But two things happened in it. One is that the commissar in question is a woman, and she's pregnant, and she's going to have a baby, and she's lodged with, she is detached from her unit, she's the commissar of a Red Army unit, i.e. the political head of it. She is lodged with a family while she has her baby, and that family is a Jewish family. And this is the most full frontal portrayal of Jewish shtetl culture of the Soviet period. And Roland Bykov plays the head of the family in a completely Jewish manner. Of course, he was Jewish, as were many Russian actors. And somehow that combination of the the pregnant commissar and the Jewish family made the film just unacceptable to Soviet authorities, and it was just completely, completely banned. But a great discovery when it did appear. And the other film, which is very interesting, that appeared in Perestroika is the beginning of a new or an unknown century, which is it was commissioned to celebrate the anniversary, the 50th anniversary of the October Revolution. These anniversaries were always marked in the Soviet calendar, of course. And two filmmakers, originally it was going to be a triptych, but one filmmaker dropped out and the film was never made. The two films that were made were by Larissa Shepitko and Andrei Smirnov. Both, of course, were well known as filmmakers, eventually. Smirnov went on to make what was actually a very popular film called Belarusian Station in 1970. But it was not known that he had made his section of this film called Angel, which is another film set during the Civil War, but it's on the other side. It's a film made from the point of view of the white units, the anti-Bolshevik units, and it shows them in action, as it were. It's not, you know, glorifying them. It's a brutal film, shows them as absolute gangsters and terrorists, but something about that film stuck in the throats of the censors. Shepitka's version, part of it, called From the Homeland of Electricity, is based on a story by Platonov. He was a very deeply disapproved of writer. And it's an extraordinary film, The Homeland of Electricity. These films were not euphoric celebrations of the Great October Revolution, to put it mildly. And they were considered, obviously, inappropriate. And by the time they were made, in 67, 68, a full-scale rearguard action was in place against the Khrushchev reforms. Khrushchev was out, although still alive, and many of the Khrushchev policies were in reverse. His social policies, especially his cultural policies, and there was a new call to order. This is the beginning of the Brezhnev period. So the Brezhnev period marks a demand and an insistence that, as it were, old-style communist codes are maintained and reinforced. And a former general, Romanov, I think was his name, was put in charge of enforcing discipline. And filmmakers suddenly felt that all the rules had changed and they had to make very conformist films. So it became extremely difficult to make non-conformist films from 67 onwards. And that's not unconnected with the 50th anniversary of the revolution, which kind of marks. One of the films that did get made in the early 60s was L.M. Klimov's debut feature. The title in English isn't great, but it's Welcome or No Admission to Unauthorized Personnel. It's a translation of what appears on the gate of a holiday camp for children, a young pioneer camp. And the fact that it's, you know, welcome, no admission, that paradox runs right through the film. A wonderful film. And the story behind the film is that, it was made as his graduation film from FGIK, and it was immediately banned on the grounds that the mother of the young central character was thought to look like Khrushchev. And the censors said that, well, we can't have this going out because it's obviously, you know, poking fun at Khrushchev. Then Khrushchev saw the film and thought it was absolutely wonderful, and immediately it was released. I believe that's true. That's what Klimov told me, and I'm sure it is true. Okay, so I hope that gives you a bit of a sense of who we're looking at. Now, I want to show you a couple of extracts. Sorry, I hope I'm not going on too long, but perhaps I am. Anyway, maybe we won't get as far as me showing you the DVD, but anyway, which is a pity, but still, there you go. I want to show you The one non-canonic film, or just a little bit of, these are very short extracts, by Tarkovsky. Tarkovsky is obviously a special subject. The most canonized figure of the Soviet period, really, of post-war Soviet period. And there's a lot that one could say about Tarkovsky. What I would want to say is that I think it's misleading to see him as a martyr, as somebody who was, you know, crushed or a victim of Soviet film bureaucracy and apparatus. In many ways, Tarkovsky is, I think, the opposite of that. He's somebody whose talent was recognized early on, who was given incredible resources to make the films that he wanted to make. He really had very little difficulty in making the films that he wanted to make. Okay, there were obstacles, there were problems. Sometimes the authorities were unsure whether they should release them, like Andrei Rublev, for instance, especially, and The Mirror as well. But they always got shown. And any suggestion, this has been said often, that his films were impossible to see in the Soviet Union is absolutely and totally untrue. A Russian film scholar, who I know, made a chart showing that there was never a moment when there was not a film of Tarkovsky's on the screen somewhere around Moscow. Always. They weren't showing in big cinemas. Why would they be? But they were always visible. He was very highly regarded. He was problematic. He was an awkward bugger in every sense of the word. I found him awkward. Everybody found him awkward. Incredibly awkward. But he was given enormous resources. And in fact, when his film Stalker, when it ran into difficulties in production and the whole first shoot had to be abandoned, it was Yuli Reisman who gave him the money to completely reshoot the film. And as Reisman said to me, at least two other films did not get made because we gave the money to Tarkovsky to reshoot his film. And so that I think you can take as absolutely true and also an indication of just how well regarded he was. But he was also a typical member of that generation that emerged just in the aftermath of Stalin's death, who experienced extraordinary freedoms in the late 50s and in the early 60s. And this is his graduation film, The Steamroller and the Violin, made while he was still at film school. And it's very typical of that aspiration of the late 50s and early 60s. This is before he made Ivan's Childhood, his first official feature. And it just gives you a sort of sense of a different, that wasn't what was supposed to happen. Mm-hmm. Sorry, pressing the wrong. It's just a little fragment to give you a sense of the texture of it.
Mm-hmm. Ну что ты, сыночка, ну что ты. Четыре – это хорошо. Это же неплохо, четыре.
Well, that, I think, to me, that speaks volumes. It's in a sense, it's Tarkovsky as a member of his newly liberated generation. He was taught at Pegeek by Mikhail Rom, who had been a leading figure in Stalin-era cinema, but who believed very strongly in giving his students a sense that anything was possible. And Tarkovsky always spoke very glowingly of him, as did everybody who was taught by Rom. And Rom is the man, by the way, that we feature in our exhibition here, who was due to play Queen Elizabeth I in drag for Eisenstein back in the 1940s. But that same Mikhail Rom became the inspiring teacher for Tarkovsky's generation. And what's so telling about that little film is its lack of bombast. I think the little boy picking his nose is terribly telling, because that's not the way people behave in earlier Soviet films. They behave very properly. And although it's just a very simple film school film, I think it tells us where Tarkovsky's coming from before he discovers the themes and the subjects of the later films, which of course he will make his own. For me, his greatest film would be The Mirror. And in many ways, The Mirror returns to that kind of minute observation of daily behavior through earlier phases of Russian life. Of course, Tarkovsky is famous for other things, for big themes, big statements, sort of pseudo-philosophical profundity. But I think he is actually a better filmmaker of the everyday, of the social. Just a trailer. This is the only way to show you a little bit of Klimov's film if you haven't seen it. It's just a little trailer that bangs together some moments from the film. Basically, what happens is that the little boy escapes from this young pioneer's camp to go home, and is rounded up and brought back, and goes into hiding. And leads a kind of underground existence in the camp, while the whole authoritarian style of Soviet youth culture is ruthlessly satirized. This is the American trailer for it. You can find it online, well worth seeing if you haven't seen it. Delightful film. And Klimov went on to make The Adventures of a Young Dentist. It's his second film. ran into More Problems, which is an extraordinary film too, also a kind of very offbeat comedy. And then he turned, in a way, to more serious themes with his later films, including the absolutely terrifying film Come and See, Idias Matri, which marks the turning point between his pre-perestroika career and, sadly, his last film, because when Klimov took up the challenge of steering the Filmmakers Union into a new era, he assumed that he would be able to go back to making films. But 'twas not to be. He managed to hand over the reins of the union to Andrei Smirnov, who took over after about 4 years. And when Klimov tried to return to directing, he found he was blocked in all kinds of ways. He wanted to make The Master and Margarita, Bulgakov novel, and he found he couldn't get the rights to make it. He was absolutely mortified by this, couldn't believe that it was it was impossible for a Soviet filmmaker, as he then still was, not to get the rights to that, but he couldn't. And he died, sadly, a very, very disappointed man, having failed to return to his career. A great filmmaker, I think, but unfulfilled in the end. But I want to show you a little clip, just a fragment from an early film by Larisa Shepitko. Shepitko is best known today, I guess, for her film The Ascent, which lends itself to a kind of spiritual, almost religious quality. It's a wartime film, but it includes a kind of crucifixion scene. But this is a really interesting early film that she made, Wings, which belongs to a genre of Soviet cinema about flying. Yuli Reisman had kicked this off back in the 30s with a film called Lyotchki, Flyers, a terrific film. And there's a whole little series of films about, the social life of people who are pilots, mostly, obviously military pilots. And Shepitko's film is really interesting because it's got a woman pilot at the center of it. And it also stands for a certain strain of feminism in Soviet cinema, which is not to be taken for granted. So I think this is unsubtitled, I'm sorry. That doesn't tell you very much, except it gives you just, again, a sense of a texture of the film. But again, an interesting... All of her five films are extremely interesting. I thought I should also show you a little bit of Kira Muratova's Brief Encounters. Sorry, I reversed the titles earlier. I remember I said Long Farewells. It's very confusing. Her two first films are known in English as Brief Encounters and Long Farewells. It doesn't help. Brief Encounters is the film in which, her first film, which she plays the central figure. She is a town boss. She's an important bureaucrat. with a senior job responsibility and a complicated private life. And this is about the core of the film is her relationship with a young man. And there's a kind of romantic connection between them, but it's an unsatisfactory relationship. And the young man is no ordinary young man. He's played by Vysotsky, the singer-songwriter, who was one of the cult figures of Soviet culture. And this gives the film a tremendous allure because it's one of Vysotsky's appearances on screen with a number of his songs in it. But the kind of chemistry, the sort of sense of the troubled relationship between the very beautiful young Kira Muratova and Vysotsky, it makes this a fascinating film. But these two films, Brief Encounters and Long Farewells, were both shelved for a long time, only to emerge later. This gives you a chance to hear some of Vysotsky.
Скажи, ну кто я здесь буду, ну? Просто твой муж, да, и все?
Ну, почему муж? У тебя своя работа, у меня своя работа.
Ну, какая же это работа, если я ее не люблю?
Ты просто меня не любишь.
Ну, ты пойми, Валя, существуют разные профессии. Моряки, например, годами...
Ты не... просто меня не любишь.
Ну, зачем так упрямо повторять? Ты просто
меня не любишь. Зачем так упрямо повторять, что я хочу, чтобы мы были вместе? Ты не хочешь.
Ну, хорошо. Поехали за мной. Собирай вещи.
Ты знаешь, я серьезно с тобой разговариваю.
И я серьезно. Собирай вещи, поехали.
И что я там буду делать? Кашу вам варить или что?
Ну, не хочешь, не будешь варить. Собирай вещи, поедем.
Ты соображаешь, вот я вдруг все так брошу, все дела и поеду куда?
Ну, вот с этого ты начинала. Я. А я?
Ты просто... Ты эгоист.
Шли дела, у меня шли дела, и вдруг сгорели пламенем дотла, не дела, а зола. Весь год жила-была, и вдруг взяла, собрала и ушла. И вот опять веселые дела у меня, дела. Меня замучили дела, каждый день дотла. Сгорели песни и стихи, дребедень.
Ой, перестань.
А вот еще такая песня есть. В Ватикане прошел мелкий дождичек, римский папа пошел
по грибы. Ну, не нужно все играть, петь без конца. Ну, я не хочу. Я хочу, чтобы меня любили не так.
А как?
Ну, я хочу, чтобы все из-за меня бросить.
It's a bit frustrating because it's not subtitled, but it just gives you a very brief hearing. The guitar poets, as they're sometimes called, of the 60s especially, and the 70s, were a very important part of kind of Soviet popular culture. There's Vysotsky and there's Okudzhava, several others, who were tremendously popular, and they're really a kind of carryover from that period of popular poetry, Yevtushenko, Voznesensky, the poets who commanded huge audiences, which only finds its way into cinema very much around the edges. I Am 20, the film that I was talking about by Marlin Khutsaev, has got a real sense of youth culture running through it, And this is a particularly important film because it's one of the films in which Vysotsky appeared. So it's very important for, especially for Russians who remember that period. Okudzhava's songs were on the soundtracks of a number of films as well. But, you know, he's not at the center of the actual film. Now, I think we're probably almost out of time. I'm just wondering whether I should try and hook up my DVD player. Does anybody have any interest in seeing a 20-minute TV piece that shows you this all in action, or if I can get it to go? It's a good piece, and you can't see it any other way. And it has interviews with all of these people, which it was made in 1990 at the end of Perestroika. David Thompson, my friend David Thompson, who still makes programs for BBC television, and he went off to Moscow and managed to film lots of people who were still around, who you could film, and when we looked at all the stuff that he'd managed to capture, we turned it into a feature for a TV program which then existed called Moving Pictures. Once upon a time, there was a cinema program on television. Hard to believe, isn't it? Not the kind of thing we have today. And it did interesting reports on all kinds of things. It's a far off era.
I'm old, but I'll try to remember. So I think that his personality influenced all the school, and particularly his pupils, in a very strong way.
Andrei Tarkovsky was one of Rom's talented pupils, as were Andrei Smirnov and Andrei Goncharovsky.
My generation of Soviet filmmakers were the first generation after the war that were exposed to world cinema. Fully. We were allowed to see a lot of films that were in the cinematheque, and also new, fresh films came to the from the West, and we were exposed to Kurosawa, and it was gradual development. I remember me and Tarkovsky, in that sense, went through the same influences.
Both Tarkovsky and Goncharovsky played small parts in IM 20, like many young artists, in what amounts to an optimistic portrait of the Thor generation.
Всех фильмов, которые я сделал в России, очень большой вопрос. я до свидания, мальчик, считаю наиболее таким своим, ну, то, что я называю фильм, где я оставил больше своих родных могил. Вот так у меня есть такое вот выражение. Он мне близок, ну, прежде всего, в нем наиболее точно я смог выразить свою общественную, я бы сказал, ну, политическую, а общественную позицию, что ли.
Уже взрослый.
Зачем ты мне это говоришь?
When you write the script, which has been accepted by censorship committee, you can shoot whatever you want. I mean, you can really make something totally different from the script. No one will know, because no one really follows you. There is no producer of censorship or state man or state behind or shoot. There can be a big surprise if you're banned, but it was on the shelf finished.
Welcome, Hélène Kamoff's graduation film, was a satirical comedy by the Young Pioneers Camp, run along very authoritarian lines. Has only now been acknowledged as his masterpiece. 20 years ago, his revolutionary use of documentary techniques and its raw honesty provoked a total ban.
Субтитры сделал DimaTorzok.
He wanted to break with the tradition of the image of a civil war in our cinema. Good, kind, and insane threats, and disgusting human rights. We didn't dare to treat it just in the opposite way. But, and I think, I don't remember this, many years ago. I think even that we thought in this way at the time. But, well, our brain was enough to understand that the main thing is to treat civil war as a national tragedy.
Забрали документы, деньги забрали. И материалы комиссии по ремонту корейской клиники. Скажите, ладно? Спасибо. Спасибо, товарищ.
И потом стали закрывать один фильм за другим, один фильм за другим. Вот. А потом мы узнали об этом идеологическом совещании в Центральном комитете партии, вот, где уже призывали восстановить значит, Сталина, которого Хрущев значит, развенчал, где призывали в общем, к порядку идеологическому, ну, вести порядок в идеологии, а значит, и в искусстве, и в культуре.
The triumph of the writers Sieniawski and Danielle in 1965 marked the end of the thaw. The crushing of the Prague Spring in 1968 destroyed the hopes of those who had tried to give Soviet communism a human face, at least on the screen.
Молодое поколение, которое видело, если ты себя ведешь не так, не конформистски, что с тобой делать? И это воздействовало на сознание молодого поколения. И вся атмосфера общества склоняла их жить по законам цинизма, неверия, вот, а мы жили верой тогда, горящей, светящейся верой. И вот родилось другое уже следующее поколение, которое как бы облили кислотой, понимаете, и им души окислили. Вот это поколение, в общем, циников, среди которых тоже были, конечно, талантливые ребята, но они несли уже в себе тот свет, который несло наше поколение.
Come with Smirnoff's Angel later tonight on BBC Two. It's part of the anthology Beginning of an Unknown Era. And before that, an Arnon Milchan presentation of a Terry Gilliam film, The Mind Expanding.
That was a real cinema program, moving pictures. You could do fun things on it. But anyway, I think for me that's become a real sort of time capsule. I don't know if it works for you that way, but it sort of takes you back, takes me back anyway, to a moment when everything seemed possible. This is 1990. We didn't know the Soviet Union was going to come to an end. We knew that there were interesting, strong-minded people like Klimov, like Smirnov. And we thought that even though there were problems, that maybe that process that they had set in motion would continue. And in a way, I suppose it did, in a way it didn't. But the tide of rediscovery of cinema Just the last thing just to say is that during that perestroika period, from about 67 or so onwards, the unshelving of films that you saw there, for instance, really kind of created a huge amount of interest in Soviet cinema. And it really gave us a kind of new map of the 60s, completely different from the kind of received one. So we had to kind of rethink what were the important films, what were the important filmmakers, all the films we hadn't known about. And several books came out about that period. Josephine Wall wrote a good book. Anna Lawton wrote another interesting book, Kino Glasnost. But I sort of feel it's very unfinished business. I feel that as I go back and look at some of these things, I think there's an awful lot that's been forgotten and that was never properly excavated. And so the work of actually restoring a proper sense of what happened in late Soviet cinema still needs to be done. Anyway, I hope that's given you some things that you didn't know about before, some things to look for. It's all much more accessible now, but you need to know what you're looking for. Thank you for watching.